Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear brothers and my sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. In this pep talk here, I will be speaking about the food of the people of the book. And by food, I mean the meat of the people of the book. And you would think that issues clearly defined in the Qur'an and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would seem clear and neatly cut for us today to just practice. But however, some people are doing their very utmost at making Islam difficult to us. When you look at the Islam that came at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which of the two do you think is easier? The Islam we have today or the Islam at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And more than certain, it was the one at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Issues that were back then really nothing. Really nothing, absolutely nothing. But today, unfortunately, there is a lot of havoc and mind-numbing issues. People make big issues out of thin air. Just anything is debatable today. Anything, tons of things are made haram. But subhanAllah, at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was not as such. Tons of ahadith are kept in the hidden because they do not support a point of view. Other hadith that support the point of view are brought forward, and there we are today really scratching our head as to where we are headed with all this. But in this talk here, as I said, I am going to speak about the meat, the eating of the meat of the people of the book. And the reason why this issue came about is that one day I was talking to a gentleman, and some issues came, and we were talking about meat. And I saw on his face that every time he speaks about the Christians or the Jews, there was this expression on his face. It's like the meat is dirty and all that kind of stuff. And then I told him, by the way, do you know that when a Muslim slaughters an animal and a Christian slaughters animal, it's exactly the same thing. It's halal for both. He goes, no, it's not. I said, yes, it is. And then I said, it's in the Qur'an. And obviously this person doesn't read the Qur'an in Arabic and was surprised to hear that. He said, I thought the meat of the Jews and the Christian is haram on us. And I said, well, you know what? It is not. And this is what has led me to speak about this topic from a really different angle. I want, after you have finished listening to this talk here, to never have any doubts anymore or remain without any knowledge or anything. You would have a clear idea as what to do exactly with the meat of the people of the book. But the very first thing I want to speak about is the universality of Islam. At the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Islam was universal, beautiful, and very eternal. Islam was really easy, simple, and helped people grow and become better. But these days, it is not the case. You would find someone who is not practicing, he's happy and all that kind of stuff. And as soon as they start practicing, that's it. They become completely different, negative people. You will find two friends, they are absolutely having a good time. And as soon as they start practicing Islam, they start fighting. This is bid'ah, that is in our, and the list goes on. So the way Islam has been rewritten, and the whole purpose is that because the Islam we have today, most of it is not what happened exactly at Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time. Most of it has been rewritten by Bani Umayyah and also by the Dawla al-Abbasiyah. A lot of what we experience today was written by scholars in the 3rd century, i.e. 1,100 years ago. Sadly so, today in the 21st century, there are some people, the scholars, that tell us that we must practice the Islam that was at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is impossible. The time how they were thinking about that time there is different. Yes, there are certain things in Islam that do not change, but there are other laws that have changed, and bi-idhillah tabaraka wa ta'ala, we will see these as we grow along with this topic. Now, someone might say, hey, this is a big claim that you say that Islam has been rewritten and things like that. I will tell you yes. Well, I'm going to take you here on a journey with one of the servants of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And his name is Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu. And he has like loads of hadith in al-Bukhari Muslim. He's a well-known person in Islam. He died in the year 90 after the Hijrah of Rasulullah, and he was one of those people that lived a very long time. He witnessed the Khilaf of Abu Bakr radiallahu anh. He witnessed the Khilaf of Umar radiallahu anh, Uthman and Ali. He also saw the battles and everything that took place between the Sahaba, and he lived until the time of Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi, the person that really humiliated Anas ibn Malik alayhi rahmatullah. Anas really spent 10 years serving Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and even in the battle of Badr, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went out to fight Quraysh, Anas went with him, not as a fighter, but more of a servant and a helper. This great companion, as I said, radiallahu anhu, witnessed throughout history. He saw a lot of things that had been changed in Islam. So one day when he was living in Al-Kufa, he was really humiliated great deal by Al-Hajjaj, who was a servant and great general of the Bani Umayyah. Would you believe that this Al-Hajjaj branded Anas with fire in the neck to mark him? And so much so. Why? Because Anas radiallahu anhu was a lover and great supporter of Ali radiallahu anhu. And as you know, Banu Umayyah and Ali, they don't work together radiallahu an Ali wa arda. But in any way, here is a hadith reported in Al-Bukhari an Ghaylan radiallahu anhu that Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu qal, ma a'rifu shay'an mimma kana ala ahdi an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qil as-salat qal alaysa dayya'tum ma dayya'tum fiha. Ghaylan radiallahu anhu reports that Anas said when he came to Damascus, where Banu Umayyah was, the headquarters, and he saw a lot of things have changed, and he was so surprised radiallahu anhu that he said, I do not recognize any of the things which were at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The way people are behaving in Islam, the way what they're practicing, what they were saying, the way they were speaking about the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's just all changed. And Anas was completely shocked. Then one of them, Ghaylan, said to him, what about as-salat? We are still performing as-salat. And then Anas radiallahu anhu said, haven't you wasted of it what you have? Because Banu Umayyah at that time there, they were really horrible at delaying as-salat. For example, al-Jum'ah, they would delay salat al-Jum'ah until Maghrib. And it remained like that until the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu. But this is not the topic about that. But it is in this turmoil here that the events and our religion were shaped in the time of Banu Umayyah and Bani al-Abbas. And only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how the beauty of Islam was at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And unless Allah sends us some godly, authentic, and free scholars who will rewrite and recode our deen back to how it was meant before, when it was at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and remove it from the grip of the fiqh and understanding of Banu Umayyah and Bani al-Abbas. And Islam at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was full of compassion. It was full of ease, full of love. It was free from the grip of governmental scholars. It was free from the grip of organized religion. It was universal, where women were equal to men, not their seconds, where the Qur'an was the source, not as today is the case. The hadith takes over the Qur'an, and hardly ever we hear the Qur'an used as evidences. When the hadith and the application did not compete with Al-Qur'an, but they were explaining and always followed Al-Qur'an, where scholars did not control the book of Allah. Today, subhanAllah, I see how scholars speak about the book of Allah. They took full control about the book of Allah. When they don't like something, they don't understand it, all they gotta say is it has been abrogated, meaning the meanings or the rulings of that ayah in Al-Quran are no longer valid. Wallahi, it's something that renders you absolutely crazy. But anyway, where what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran is not manipulated or wrongly interpreted or criminally changed. Sometimes Allah says something, it's plain. I'll give you an example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Al-Quran says, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّلْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرٍ. Allah has made Al-Quran easy to remember, to speak, to understand, to ponder upon. But when you look in the books of our, what the scholars have put, that in order for you to understand the Qur'an, you must, they put four conditions. Condition number one, you must know Arabic. Condition number two, you must know the history of every ayah that was revealed. You must understand al-Nasikh and al-Mansukh. And you must, wallahi al-Azim, it's headaches. Allah says the Qur'an is easy to understand and memorize and apply. And these people say, no, you need to know Arabic and you need to know the grammar and you need to know this and that. Who do we believe these days? This is why we Muslims today, we feel distant from the Qur'an, because they have set some laws, and these laws, they don't agree with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said. But anyway, back to the people of the book. To really have a grip about how to behave with the food, i.e. the meat of the people of the book, let's take a journey. A journey into the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then see how he, as a person, behaved, and then how his companion, radiallahu anhum, also behaved. And the reason I say this is because when I speak to Muslims today about the meat, they say, no. The Jews and the Christians at the time of Rasulullah are not the same as those present today. And this is a very dangerous statement. It's like they say, Allah didn't know back then. And now people have changed, and the law, when they were revealed back then, Allah revealed them on the people there, but the people have changed. And this is like a statement of disbelief, al-iyadu billah. But anyway, I just want you here to close your eyes and follow my voice into the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and imagine yourself now walking in Al-Madinah, and all you hear is Allah says the Quran has been revealed, and there is this ayah and that ayah, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam applying the Quran to the letter. At the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Al-Madinah, or in the Arabian Peninsula, there used to be Jews and Christians greatly scattered around. Don't think that there were no Christians in the Arabian Peninsula. They were actually a great. And they were the Jews as well. Just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes them in Al-Quran, the Jews were the followers of At-Tawrat. They were also followers of the Ten Commandments, along with playing and manipulating the texts to their advantage. And on top of that, the Jews claimed that Uzair was the son of Allah. And this is all reported in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, angels, just men, and pious people that are descendant of Seth or Sheth, the third son of Adam alayhi salam, kings of Israel, are all called son of God. This is in the Old Testament, so it's not only about Isa alayhi salam, but this is also in the beliefs of the Jews. The Jews said that Israel is the son of Allah. وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ عُزَيْرٌ إِبْنُ اللَّهِ. And this is in the Tawbah, Surah 9, Ayah 30. So the Jews were very impolite, and they were disrespectful, and they were accusative with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even with that, Allah said, we can eat their meat. Al-Yahud, they made some big claims. وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ يَدُ اللَّهِ مَغْلُولَةٌ. They said, the Jews, that the hand of Allah is chained, shackled, and tied up, i.e. Allah is stingy, he doesn't spend, waliyadu billah. And they also, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered back on them, غُلَّتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ, i.e. let their hands be chained, and may they be cursed. And until today, the Jews are known worldwide as being the stingy people, the money lovers, and that is in response to what they have accused Allah wrongly, waliyadu billah. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Al-Quran, لَقَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَقِيرٌ وَنَحْنُ أَغْنِيَاءٌ. Yani Allah has heard the statement of those who said, Allah is the poor and we are the rich. And this is in Ali Imran. So they claim, subhanAllah, why? مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يُقْرِضُ اللَّهَ قَرْضًا حَسَنًا. Who will lend to Allah a beautiful lending? The Jews said, why would Allah ask us to donate to him? Therefore, he is poor and we are the rich people. This is like a very corrupted misunderstanding. And it's also worth knowing, my dear brothers and my sisters, that the Jews of today are exactly those of old: players, arrogant, manipulative, assassins, killers, racists, and abusers, and full of themselves. That's who the Jews are. Nothing much has changed from them. So, and the Jewish racism that was at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam towards the non-Jews exists today. Would you believe it? In Sahih al-Bukhari, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, لو آمن بي عشرة من اليهود لآمنت يهود. If 10 of their scholars, of the children of Israel, believed in Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all the Jews would have believed in Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but that didn't happen. Let me read some parts of At-Talmud, that is the book of the children of Israel, in which they have some teachings about those that are not Jews. Listen to this. The Jews are called human beings. This is what is taught in the books of religion of the Jews, in the Talmud. The Jews are called human beings, but the non-Jews are not humans, they are beasts. And the non-Jews meaning anyone who is not a Jewish. And this is in the Talmud Baba Maziyah and 114b. That's the reference to the book and the surah and the number of their verse. And then they said in another one, the soul of non-Jews come from impure spirits and are called pigs. That's how they refer to us, the Gentile. And this one again is in Talmud, in Jalkut Rubani Gadol, and that's 12b. Another one, if you eat with a Gentile, that is you and me and everyone else, it is the same as eating with a dog. And this is within two spots, Jobamoth 94b. Believe me, I don't understand these Jewish names, but it's just like us in Al-Baqarah, Ali Imran, but it's in Hebrew. Also another one, a pregnant non-Jew is no better than a pregnant animal. And this is in Koshen Hamshvit 405. So a non-Jew that is pregnant to them is just like a dog or a cattle that is also pregnant. Another one, it says, every Jew who spills the blood of the godless, i.e. the non-Jews, is doing the same as making a sacrifice to God. And this is in the Talmud, Bamidbar, Rabbah C21. Also, in another one, it says the sexual intercourse between Gentiles is like intercourse between animals. And this is also in the Talmud, Sanhedrin 74b. And the last one, because I don't want to bore you with all these racist statements, but for you to understand that they have them also. It's just they have the media, and that's why they label us Muslims with what they already got in their own books. The last one, it says, it is the law to kill anyone who denies the Torah. The Christians belong to the denying ones of the Torah. And this is again in the Koshen, Hamshipat 425. So as you can see, these were the Jews that were at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These are the Jews that insulted Allah, that manipulated, killed, and are big racist and everything. These are the people that Allah told us that to eat their meat. And we shall see later on the how. The second part now are the Nasara, or what's referred to them generally here by Christians. And for simplicity's sake, I will refer to them as Christians or An-Nasara. So whichever one comes, it's the same thing. Now, these Christians, they also have received their share of description in Al-Quran. The Bible, as you know it, is divided into well-defined sections, the Old Testament and the New Testament. However, the word Testament is an old English word that means covenant. In the early days, it was called covenant. But when they translated from the Hebrew covenant into Greek, it became testament. This is why in the Latin languages today, the word became the Old and New Testament. When they mean the Old Testament is the testament or the covenant or the books that were sent before the coming of Isa, Jesus, son of Mary. The new one is the one that were given to Isa, alayhi salam, Jesus, son of Mary, and to him, that is what it is. So the Jews, they do not recognize the New Testament. The Jews, they completely reject the New Testament, and they also reject Al-Quran. For education purposes, the type of Christians that were at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam are exactly the type of Christians that exist today. The very first ones of them are those who said that Allah is the Messiah, is Jesus, son of Mary. To them, Allah is that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لَقَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْمَسِيحُ بْنُ مَرْيَمُ. They have disbelieved those who say Allah is the Messiah, son of Mary. وقال المسيح يا بني إسرائيل اعبدوا الله ربي وربكم. And said the Messiah unto them when they said these words, children of Israel, worship Allah, my God and your God. So as you can see here, it's clearly apparent that the children of Israel, the Christians today, they also believe that Jesus was a God. The second portion of them, or the second category of them, is those that said Allah is the third of three, the Trinity, the Catholicism. لقد كفر الذين قالوا إن الله ثالث ثلاثة وما من إله إلا إله واحد. They have disbelieved those who say Allah is the third of three, if of the Trinity, and there is no deity but one unique one, and that is Allah. And this is in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Ayah 73. So as you can see, at the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, there were those who believed that Allah was Jesus, and there were those who believed that Allah was part of three, Trinity. And the third category that exists today and existed at the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam are those that say the Messiah is the Son of Allah, Jesus, Son of God. وقالت النصارى المسيح ابن الله ذلك قولهم بأفواههم. The Christians say the Messiah is the Son of Allah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers back to them, that is just what they say with their mouths, i.e. there is nothing of real in that claim. So my dear brothers and my sisters, as you can see, the Christians of before are the Christians of today, and the Jews of today are the Jews of before. Absolutely no difference whatsoever. So don't you ever make the mistake saying bad people have changed. At the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Christians and the Jews were exactly like you see them today. Some of them applied their teaching, some of them didn't, some of them went to the church and the synagogue, some of them didn't. And even at the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, their women of the Christians and the Jews were beautiful. In Surah At-Tawbah, one of the Bedouins who didn't want to go with Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to Ghazwat Tabuk, he said, "Ithalli wa la taftanni." Allah mentions this in Al-Quran when he said, "Ya Rasulullah, inna banat al-ahmar," the daughters of the red skins or the blondes, they are a big fitna for me. And if I go with you to fight, I will commit zina. So please allow me to stay here. But the reason he said that obviously is that because he didn't want to go with Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So as you can see, not much has changed. So what is the exact relationship between the three books, and that is At-Tawrat, Al-Injil, the Gospel, and Al-Quran? So let me start by speaking about the book that was revealed to Musa alayhi as-salam, At-Tawrat. At-Tawrat, my dear brothers and my sisters, had 613 clear-cut laws, halal, haram, i.e. For example, in the law of Musa alayhi salam, anyone who commits adultery must be stoned to death with stones. Anyone who disobeys his parents, is nasty to them, must be also killed. So they had laws where it is this for that, you do this, that is really, really clear-cut ones. So much so that Rabbi Simlai in the 3rd century, in a sermon, deliberated this and said that there were 613 laws in the law of Musa alayhi salam, and this became a part of their book, and it is mentioned in the Talmud, Makot 23b. When Isa alayhi salam was given the gospel, and the gospel is nothing else but the meaning of it is the good news coming from the kingdom of God. Isa alayhi salam, when he came with the gospel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear what was the purpose. Yes, he came alayhi salam to remind of the children of Israel, but he came with another purpose. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this, وَمُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيَّ مِنَ التَّوْرَاتِ وَلِأُحِلَّ لَكُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي حُرِّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ. Isa alayhi salam tells the children of Israel, and I have come confirming authentication or unconfirming and authenticating what was before me, i.e. the book of At-Tawrat, and to make lawful, halal for you, some of what was made forbidden for you. And this is in Ali Imran. As you can see here, Allah made it explicitly clear that Isa alayhi salam came with some laws to change the 613 and take some of these laws and made them halal for the children of Israel. then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to Al-Quran as a book that removes away the shackles from the children of Israel. So what shackles did Al-Quran came to remove from the children of Israel? Subhanallah. Al-Quran, my dear brothers and my sisters, unlike the Torah and the Gospel, doesn't have too much haram in it. When Allah uses the term haram in Al-Quran, we must use haram only for what Allah has used haram. And let me explain to you what is the difference between saying something is haram and something is not permitted. When we say something haram, that is the highest degree of prohibition, only Allah has the authority to issue it. Not permitted, for example, smoking, you cannot say smoking is haram, because anyone will demand a clear text where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or his messenger says that that is haram. You can say smoking is not permitted, that is fine. You can say smoking is a sin, that is fine. But don't say it is haram. A lot of people, they come and say Coca-Cola is haram. And I tell them, you really understand what you're saying? The moment you open your mouth and you utter the word haram, you have given yourself a right only due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The major difference between the Quran and the previous books, inherently between the Judaism and Islam and the Gospel, is that the previous laws were very firm, while the Islamic teachings that we have today are very flexible. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions it very, very, very clear, and absolutely made it sure that the prohibition with the term haram in Al-Quran are not more than 14. So how is the Islamic law? The Islamic law is boundaries, not the absolutes like the Torah of Musa alayhi salam. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah yaqul tilka hududullahi fala taqrabuha. Those are the limits of Allah, so do not approach them. And yet in Surah Al-Baqarah, again in ayah 229, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says tilka hududullahi fala ta'taduha. These are the limits of Allah, so do not transgress them. I'll give an example. If someone kills someone, in the law of Musa alayhi salam, you kill, you get killed. But in Islam, it's not like that. In Islam, in our religion, the highest of what you can do is a soul for a soul, a nafs bin nafs. Yet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encourages us to forgive. Subhanallah. فَمَنْ عُفِيَ لَهُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls the murderer and the one who has been called أخيه, a brother. So in Islam, the limits are, they go from forgiving to taking a soul for a soul. In the law of Musa alayhi salam, that was not permitted. La ilaha illallah, that was not permitted. So when al-Islam came, it really came to remove 613 and only replace them with 14. Isn't that a great deal of easiness to the children of Israel? Yes, it is. So instead of the black and white, subhanallah, al-Islam is beautiful and it has a minimum and a maximum. So with this small introduction about the children of Israel and what they did, let's go a little bit deeper in about this story or these rulings about the meat of the people of the book. Before going any further, let's take a look at the people of the book at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and now. The Arabian Peninsula had loads of Christians living in it at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and even before that and after his death sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There were Jews and Christians in Al-Yemen, and they were also in Al-Habasha, Ethiopia today. They were in Egypt, lots of them. Mecca, there were some Jews and Christians also. North Africa, and they were also in northern parts of the Middle East, in Lebanon, Palestine, Jordan, Syria, Iraq, Turkey, and Greece. So as you can see, they were all over around. Even after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some tribes that were Muslims at the time of Rasulullah went back to Christianity. Of them were Banu Aqil and also Bani Kalb. All this went back to Christianity, and the Jews were also scattered in the same lands as those I mentioned. Therefore, my dear brothers and my sisters, the Jews and Christians were scattered and they were well known at the time of Rasulullah. Al-Islam did not reveal or did not come and did not speak about the people of the book out of fiction only. Actually, they had a real life experience with the Muslim at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and after. So not much, my dear brothers and my sisters, has changed from the Jews and Christians of before. They are the same as they are today, and today they are the same, the principles are the same, and everything is still the same. So, but what is the relationship of al-Islam? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command us and he says it is okay, it is halal to eat their meat? Or why some scholars prohibit us from eating their meat? What is the relationship of al-Islam? My dear brothers and my sisters, to really get a good idea about Islam, we must look at al-Islam at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not the Islam that came after it that were designed by Banu Umayyah or Banu Abbas. We have to look at al-Islam of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because it is highly needed, my dear brothers and my sisters, to understand that type of Islam. Because there are some groups today that their aim of existence is really build animosity between Muslims and the rest of the world, specifically, especially the Jews and then the Christians. You hear the Muslims insulting the Jews, calling them pigs and monkeys, and Rasulullah didn't call them that. And Allah, who they insulted, called them children of Israel, Bani Israel. And when Allah is angry with them, he called them the Jews, al-Yahud. But never did he insult them the way we do today. So there are some Muslims and some school of thoughts today whose purpose and aim, subhanAllah, is just breeding animosity between the children of Israel, i.e. the Jews and the Christians, and us. This is why it is important, before we discuss the issue of eating their meat or marrying their women, is that we understand exactly what it is that al-Islam wants from us. The other day I was given a talk at the university, and there was somebody from Saudi Arabia, and he was telling me that there is an American Islam, and I told him, why is it American? It's because, he says, because they ask us like to love people and have compassion and mercy, while Islam commands us to fight. And I told him, stop it. Just come out of that shell. Here is why Islam didn't come to kill people. And I'm not saying this because of American Islam. This is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he allowed us to eat their meat and marry their women, there is a purpose behind that. And that is because what the three books carried together in matters of belief is the same. Look at this. Both the Jews, the Christians and Muslims, they believe in Allah as the one. Yes, they are associated. Yes, they did that. But deep inside them, they say, oh my God. They also believe in the angels. They believe in the books. They believe in the messengers. They believe in the last day. And they believe in the predestination. All of this exists in At-Torah and the Gospel and Al-Quran. So they are already very close to us. Who is very easy to give da'wah to or call to Islam? A Jewish, a Christian, or a Hindu and a Buddhist? You can see. Or an atheist, you can see that the Jews and the Christians are far closer to us than anyone else. Here are some few elements of unity that al-Islam has brought forth to show that al-Islam is after unison, not disunity. For example, as soon as the Salat was made compulsory on the Muslims, where did we turn to pray to? Jerusalem. And we stayed doing that 16 or 18 months, depending on which version you take. And the Muslims remained that, and Rasulullah ﷺ remained doing that, even until he migrated to Al-Madinah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is one. Number two, the way the Jews make their wudu and the way they perform their salat is very close to how we Muslims do that. So much so that when you look at how they perform a salat and how they make their wudu, you see that actually Al-Islam came to add to what they already had. Number three, the unison of the name of the father of the messengers, Ibrahim alayhi salam. In Surah Al-Baqarah, strangely enough, whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to Ibrahim in Surah Al-Baqarah, he doesn't call him Ibrahim. He calls him Ibrahim. He calls him Abraham, unlike the other parts of the Quran. Why? Because the Jews used to call him also Abraham. So as you can see here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants, and Al-Baqarah is the first to have been revealed in Al-Madinah. So it's kind of like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Abraham, children of Israel, this prophet Abraham is the same one as the one you have in the Torah. Also, the Medina constitution, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to Al-Madinah, the first thing he did is he signed a treaty between him and the children of Israel. And in this there were laws and bonds and everything. And that was also a sign, we are not your enemies, we are your friends. The business dealings with them, they had the market and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with them. And the beautiful of it is when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, as in Bukhari and Muslim, he left his shield ransomed with the Jewish that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam bought some food with, and he didn't have money, so he left his shield, the shield, to later on, so that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam can pay him later on. Do you think Islam wants animosity? No. Why do we today look for animosity when Allah has allowed us to marry Jewish and Christian and to eat their meat? And before I go any further, my dear brothers and my sisters, when we speak about eating their meat and marrying their women, i.e. the people of the book, that is also, subhanAllah, look at it this way. At the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Jews and the Christians and the Muslims used to exchange dinners and foods. For example, you have your neighbor who is a Jew, you cook dinner, you give them some, they give you some, you exchange like that, as we will see later on. And you like a woman, you go and marry her. Why is that? It's because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to us that the closest to you, Muslims, they are the Jews and the Christians. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has reiterated this in the Quran countless times. I don't know why we leave politics today affect our religion. Only Allah knows that. Since the talk today is about eating their meat, I want to speak a little bit about certain issues, about the meat that we are allowed to eat. But there are certain elements that will help us understand this issue better. Let's take a look at the types of meats that we Muslims are not allowed to eat. Because what we are allowed to eat is bahimatul an'am, and we are allowed to eat the fish in the sea, and we are allowed to eat birds. I will explain this a little bit further. But I want to just here say about those foods or this meat that we are not allowed to eat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Ayah 5. حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ. So the dead animal, the dead meat is haram upon us. We cannot eat it. وَلَحْمُ الْخِنْزِيرِ. And the meat of swine. And the swine is the name that comprehends all, like the pork and the pig and everything, so the swine. وَمَا أُهِلَّ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ بِهِ. And that which has been dedicated to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like sacrificing for Satan, sacrificing for a grave, sacrificing for a deity, sacrificing for somebody else. وَالْمُنْخَنِقَةُ. Al-munkhaniqa is the strangled animal. So that is if an animal gets, for example, you're going to take a sheep. If the sheep gets strangled and dies, the meat of that animal is haram on us to eat. وَالْمَوْقُوذَ. Al-mawquza is the animal that has been hit by a violent blow. For example, a car hits that animal, or the stunning here in the UK, or for example, an animal that has been hit by a rifle, a rock, stick, and things like that. Wal-mutaraddiya. Al-mutaraddiya is the animal that falls off a cliff, a mountain, something high, the animal falls and dies. وَالنَّطِيحَ. النَّطِيحَ is when two animals fight each other. They headlong, they beat each other until they die. So at one point they keep hitting until they kill each other. وَمَا أَكَلَ السَّبُعُ إِلَّا مَا ذَكَّيْتُمْ. And what the animal, the wild animals, have eaten except that which we have slaughtered. وَمَا ذُبِحَ عَلَى النُّصُبِ. And that which has been slaughtered on stones or places of sacrifices. وأن تستقسموا بالأزلام using arrows seeking luck or decision. For example, you want to do something.